Debbie Haley, Matt Johannesman.
Here.
Jeanette Copner, Scott Folkmeyer.
Here.
Dan Coops.
Here.
Rich Masterson, James Pauley, Brian Hunman, Dick Ruffcar.
Here.
Robert Schmidt.
Here.
James Seidman.
Here.
Here.
Okay, so we do have a quorum, very good. I would accept a motion for approval of the minutes from the June 21st meeting.
Make a motion.
Second.
Any discussion or adjustments? All those in favor, say if I'm saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Thank you. At this time, we'd open up public comment. Seeing none, we'll close public comment, and we'll move on to the 2018-2020 TIP applications. And we will begin this evening with the City of St. Charles.
Good evening, I'm Nick Allen, the project manager for the City of St. Charles, and with me tonight is Dan Mann, another project manager with the City of St. Charles. And we're here to talk about the 2017 city's applications for the County Road Board funding. The city has submitted 8 projects this year. In order of priority, the first project is the systemic safety improvements. It's actually multiple locations, mostly road improvements are shown here, number one. Our second project is the Meg Road and Prong Drive traffic signal relocation. Our third project is over here at the Clark Street's enhancements. Fourth is the Skinner Industrial Drive realignment. Fifth is the Elm Street and Harden Mill School traffic signal. Sixth is the Hawksnest Drive connection to Veterans Memorial Parkway. Seventh is our Sanford I-70 overpass study. And our final project is the Yellow Point Road realignment on the front. So our first project, the systemic safety improvements. This project is focusing at 5 intersections throughout the city and 3 corridor improvements along Boonslick Road, Kings Highway, and Elm Street. At Boonslick Road, there are some sharp curves. This project's gonna address those issues. At Kings Highway, we've got clear zone obstructions. And at the Fifth Street Randolph location, there's poor sight distance due to the grades at the intersection. And then along Elm Street, our pavement striping is fading away, so we'll be restriping that corridor as well. This project has received federal STP funding. A lot of the improvements originated from the 2015 County Strategic Highway Safety Plans. They're really low-cost items that really increase the safety along these corridors. These type of upgrades are like the LED stop signs that's shown here, additional signage for intersections ahead, stop ahead, additional pavement markings, some intersection lighting, and putting reflected markings on some of the utility poles that might be within the clear zone to alert the drivers to any obstructions that might be along the roadway. Our financial plan for this project, we did receive the 80% in federal funds, so the city is requesting only 10% for the county to fund, and then the city will match the remaining 10%. Our next project is the Meggie Road and Prong Drive traffic signal relocation. Prong Drive is the entrance to Wapa Horse Park. It's located just south of Hagman Road, and our project limits are at Bogey Estates Drive and the Prong Drive. Today, there's a traffic signal at the park, but there's no signal at Bogey Estates Drive. The traffic that is coming out of Bogey Estates Drive is not just the residents here. There's actually access all the way to Zumbel Road, so it does kind of act as a cut through. So there's more traffic on that road than you might originally assume. At the Prong Drive, Wapa Horse Park entrance, the park generates about 300,000 users during the summer months. The peak times at the park are a little bit different than a traditional roadway. The AM, PM peaks don't quite line up with the usage at the park. We got, and that's due to the pool operation hours, tournaments, camps, and we've got evening leagues. But when there are significant traffics at the park, the existing approach at Prom Drive operates at a level of service of D. At the Bogey Estates Drive, we've done a very good job along the Meggie Road corridor of optimizing our traffic signals. They're now interconnected. The traffic flows smoothly along Meggie Road. But what it has created at this location is the drivers exiting out of Bogey Hills Estates or Bogey Estates Drive have a difficult time turning left and finding the gaps in the roadway. So what that's resulting in a level of service of E at this location. So also the intersection spacing between the two, they're very close together, about 430 feet apart, which is not ideal for two intersections to operate. In the photo here, this is Bogey Estates Drive here on the left, and you can kind of see the traffic signal in the background, so they are pretty closely spaced together. So this project will actually relocate Prom Drive to align with Bogey Estates Drive. So we'll relocate the traffic signal that's already here and shift it to the north to align with Bogey Estates Drive. The city has another project within the park, recently approved a Prop P, which generates some park improvements. So in 2018, the park will actually be closed. So for our application, this is kind of good timing for us to do the traffic signal work. We are only applying for the intersection improvements. So the cost that you'll see that's broken down in the application is only from the turn lanes to the intersection and any work along Meggie Road. All the work will be done within city right-of-way or park property, so no additional easements or right-of-way will be acquired for the project. After the project's completed, Bogey Estates Drive, the level of service improves from an E to a B, and the Prog Drive approach improves from a level of service of D to a C. There's also additional safety benefits along Meggie Road by protecting all the turning movements and allowing the vehicles to turn safely and not having to wait for the gaps. The financial plan for this project, we are proposing 80% to be from the county, and the city will match the remaining 20%. Clark Street Enhancements Project. This project is from Kings Highway to 2nd Street. Clark Street is an old road throughout the city. It's been around a very long time, before any of us were born, I'm sure. So earlier on, it used to be the primary access to the old 115 bridge. And at that time, the functions of Clark Street had a lot of gas stations, parking lots, and really had a lot of businesses that would cater towards the river crossing at 115. Since that bridge was removed in the late 90s, the corridor has pretty much stayed the same and hasn't really been revitalized to match its current use. So this is a map of the current zoning plan. We have several different mixed uses throughout the area. We've got some commercial up at Kings Highway, some residential use in between Kings Highway and Fifth Street, more commercial between Fifth Street and Main Street, and we have some industrial zoning along the riverfront. The corridor now isn't utilizing the highest and best use of the property along this corridor. There are, I was shown here, there's kind of some empty parking lots. There's on-street parking that has parallel parking that's not utilized. This is a vacant building that's underutilized. This is a former gas station that's now a used car lot, and it's really not, hasn't been upgraded to meet the current uses for that area. So what the city is actually doing, we're actually going to conduct a planning corridor study that's separate from this project, and that study is going to help us identify ways that we can improve the economic revitalization of this corridor and how our roadway project may be able to encourage the redevelopment of the area. This is kind of the zoning map that we saw before. It's a little hard to see, but these highlighted areas are areas where we feel could be redeveloped with roadway improvements. So the application that we've applied for is for the implementation of this study. So we put an initial concept together. We are expecting that concept to be refined with our study. And we are looking to seek additional federal funding after that study is completed. So the costs that were put together are for the initial concept, which this is kind of the initial concept that was put together. So it includes some pavement preservation by milling and overlaying the existing asphalt along Clark Street. We'll be looking at repurposing the parallel parking and using that for wider sidewalks. So anything over 5 foot in width, the city would fund. Looking at new curb and gutter, new street lighting along the corridor, storm sewer improvements, utility relocations. There are easements that are needed for sidewalk and utility relocations, but no additional right-of-way is needed for the roadway improvements themselves. This is a photo looking towards the river, way off in the background, at Clark Street. And the next slide is kind of a rendering of what Clark Street could look like. So we kind of removed some of the parallel parking and provided wider sidewalks that would also accommodate some bicycle traffic. This is another photo of an existing development along the corridor, and we envision this to be potentially redeveloped to something that could look more like a streetscape building. After our project's completed, the project will help encourage the economic redevelopment of the corridor, and the corridor will still be designed to handle any vehicle traffic and improve the pedestrian and bicycle facilities along the corridor. So the financial plan for this project, the city is requesting 80% of the improvements to be funded by the county and the remaining 20% from the city. I'll turn this over to Dan for this project.
Next project, Skinner Industrial Drive, is located just northwest of the Newtown Boulevard and 370 interchange. The current Skinner Industrial Drive is a little stub road that actually leads to a FedEx facility west of Newtown Boulevard. The primary conditions of this project will address are related to traffic flow and safety improvements. Currently in this area, there's heavy industrial truck traffic. Truck traffic, as it primarily goes to access that FedEx facility, travels north on Newtown Boulevard. It passes through the Mueller Road intersection, which is signalized, and it stops in northbound through traffic as it waits to make a left turn on the Skinner Industrial Drive. There's no dedicated left turn lane as currently configured. As they stop and wait for gaps in traffic in southbound Newtown Boulevard traffic queues up behind them, as you can see in that picture, and actually backs up into the intersection on a regular basis in most PM rushes. As that traffic backs up, it creates driver uncertainty as they approach that intersection and obvious safety concerns. We expect that this condition will only worsen as more commercial and residential development occurs in the area. The other issue in this location, there's an existing culvert that crosses under Newtown Boulevard, and that conveys the flow from Boschert Creek. It's a three-cell box culvert, and Boschert Creek currently runs parallel to Newtown Boulevard, and then makes a sharp turn and crosses under the road. That poor alignment causes some issues with that culvert and leads to some heavy siltation inside the culvert. As you can see there, there's 3 to 4 feet in places, and in a large part contributes to a bridge sufficiency rating of 66.1, which is considered a medium priority condition. Additionally, above that box culvert, there's pretty shallow cover, and the pavement is deteriorated significantly, has a pavement condition index of 63. This project scope will do several things. First, it will pull that approach to Skinner Industrial Drive. It will pull it south, just opposite of Mueller Road, and transition from two offset T intersections to one four-way stop-controlled intersection. That reconfiguration of the geometry of those two intersections will allow for a left turn lane for traffic moving northbound on Newtown Boulevard to turn into Skinner Industrial Drive without causing those traffic backups that currently cause that signal to fail. The other thing this project will do is it'll replace that culvert that crosses under Newtown Boulevard. That culvert creates upstream flooding and hampers development upstream. And the replacement of that culvert, we see is being improving the development potential of several parcels and also improving the condition of the culvert. It'll also, that connection from Skinner, from across from Mueller up towards Bethman Road, we see the possibility to make several drive connections to existing industrial parcels that currently connect to MB Industrial Drive at a road just north of Skinner Industrial. And that'll further reduce traffic that's trying to make left turns off of Newtown Boulevard and encourage growth north of Bethman Road. This is our conceptual plan. You can see the connection to Newtown Boulevard across from Mueller Road, and it extends north, north is that direction, to Bethman Road. These parcels are mostly developed. They're industrial in their current state, and we're proposing adding driveways to each of those parcels that allow easier access for them through a signalized intersection and allow better access for those industrial parcels and for the parcels to the north of Bethman Road, allow better and safer access for them to get back to Highway 370. It'll also upgrade the box culvert in this location and remove the access for Skinner Industrial Drive just north of Mueller Road. The typical section that we're proposing is two 12-foot through lanes and one center two-way left turn lane. This is a schematic showing the existing conditions. You can see the industrial development here. This is a FedEx facility and the current alignment of Skinner Industrial Drive up to the north. And these are the parcels north of Bethman Road that we see as having development potential. This slide shows the realignment of Skinner Road, the elimination of that approach, and the addition of these drives to reroute some of the traffic off MB Industrial Drive and reduce the backups of traffic that currently occur at the Mueller Road intersection. This will also allow that easier, safer access to these parcels back to Highway 370, and the upgraded box culvert will help with potential development upstream. This is that parcel that I keep referring to north of Bethman Road. We see is having development potential with this connection for the easier, safer access.
Is that all floodplain out there now?
I believe it is. So our project outcomes for this project, this project will provide easier, safer access back to 370, and it'll also provide easier, safer access for drivers traveling north and southbound on Newtown Boulevard, especially as traffic increases there. It'll reduce the frequency of backups or delays as they cross through the Mueller Road intersection. It'll also improve the culvert condition and the alignment of the existing culvert under Newtown Boulevard. The financial plan for this project, the city is requesting 80% funding from the county, with the remaining 20% coming from city funds.
This is our Elm Street and Harden Middle School traffic signal project. This is zoomed in, but the location of this is just north of Kings Highway, and it's actually two schools in this area. There's the Harden Middle School, and then just north of Harden is Blackhurst Elementary School. Currently at Harden Middle School, they have a turnable stop sign. And during school hours, they turn the stop sign for traffic to stop along Elm Street, and then after school hours, they manually turn it back so that the traffic can flow free along Elm Street. It's kind of an inefficient way to move our traffic. We still experience significant queuing and delays along Elm Street during during the parent and bus drop-off and pickup times. The school district has a new bond issued that will help fund some additional access improvements to both the Lacrosse Elementary School and the Hardin Middle School. And they did set aside some fundings for a new traffic signal at this location. Let's go to the next slide. The city is only requesting funds for the new traffic signal portion. So the other parking lot improvements, those will all be made with strictly just school district funds. This traffic signal would eliminate that turnable stop sign, and that signal would be programmed to accommodate both the peak flows along Elm Street and the peak pickup and drop-off times for the school. After the project's completed, it will increase the safety along Elm Street by protecting all the turning movements and improve the traffic flow as well. The city is requesting 50% of it to be funded by the county, and then the remaining funds would be split 25% from the city and another 25% from the school district.
The $300,000 was just the signal?
Correct, for just the traffic.
Is that different than what you had in the...
It should be the same.
Yeah.
Oh, it's in here, Mike. Okay, good.
Next project, Hawks Nest Connection to Veterans Memorial Parkway, is proposed, located just west of Hawks Nest Drive on this triangular parcel that was the former home of the Mr. Steak restaurant. The existing condition that this project will address is essentially related to traffic operation. Currently, traffic traveling between Veterans Memorial Parkway and Hawks Nest Drive, they currently have to cross over private property in order to travel between. They can either use this access and cut across this parking lot or cut through the shopping center down to Veterans Memorial. Additionally, Veterans Memorial, if converted to future one-way outer roads, Hawks Nest is centrally located between Sunbelt and First Capital, and this is a preferred location for a movement that would allow drivers traveling east on Veterans Memorial to turn up on Hawks Nest and go back westbound on the north outer one-way outer road. This is a photo that shows a zoomed in picture of the ramp that leads up to Hawks Nest. You can see Hawks Nest, it climbs up fairly steep as it goes to cross over I-70. The ramp that leads from the current parking lot up to Hawks Nest is also steep and narrow, and those are both things that we hope to address with this project. This is a schematic showing a one-way outer road configuration along I-70. You can see Zumbel here in First Capital on the other side. And this is the highlighted location of our proposed project. You can see this is a connection that is necessary for traffic driving east. If this is a one-way outer road driving east, you get off on Hawks Nest and travel back westbound on the north outer road. And also for traffic, if they look to access I-70 going east or westbound. There's actually a slip ramp shown here and here. So the scope of our improvements, this connection will be configured to fit the current two-way configuration of Veterans Memorial Parkway. The design will also ensure feasibility if there are any future one-way outer road configurations, and allow for easy modifications to allow for that operation. The construction will include a pavement, barrier, retaining walls, and also traffic signal work up at Hawks Nest Drive. And it'll be stop controlled down at Veterans Memorial Parkway. This is a concept plan for these improvements. This is the area up at Hawks Nest. This will be signalized. Down at Veterans Memorial, this is planned to be stop controlled. Our typical section on the opposite side of the screen It shows some retaining wall work that's necessary. Our section is 2 12-foot lanes with 8-foot shoulders. That'll allow some safety for drivers, allow them to pull over, but it'll also allow any trucks that use this connection to have some off-tracking capabilities. It's separated by a 4-foot concrete median, and it separates the directions of travel. Yes, sir.
You're going to signalize that. You've got a signal right there at Plaza.
Plaza Way, yeah. Yeah, so there is another signal there, and that's something that, we will look at and evaluate in design and determine if there's something that we can do either with signal timing or look at some configuration of how those signals work together. This is an aerial view showing the existing site. This is the old Mr. Steak. This is the ramp that leads up to Hawk's Nest. And this is a conceptual rendering of what these improvements would look like. It would be stop control down at Veterans Memorial. Traffic will come up, and there will be a signalized intersection up at Hawk's Nest. After this project's complete, the project outcomes will be improved access to the current two-way configuration at Veterans Memorial for traffic wishing to travel between Hawk's Nest and Veterans Memorial Parkway. It'll also allow for future one-way configurations for the outer roads. And that'll also allow access to east and westbound I-70 for any slip ramps in the area. The financial plan for this project, the city is requesting 80% funds from the county, with the remaining 20% coming from city funds. Next project is a study. It's the Sanford I-70 overpass study. And this is going to look at an area between Truman and Zumbel. It's going to look at a parallel alignment that connects Maggie Road up to Truman Boulevard and has an overpass somewhere near the Batterock College and bisects the Sanford Farm parcels. The existing conditions say currently north of I-70 and east of the K Springs interchange, there's over 150 acres of underdeveloped agricultural land. This acreage is identified on future land use maps as being zoned as commercial. The agricultural zoning doesn't represent the highest and best use of these parcels. Additionally, any future one-way outer road configuration, the spacing between the Cave Springs and the Zumbel Road interchange is too wide, too far apart. So it's going to be necessary to provide some sort of U-turn movement in between those two existing interchanges. So this general vicinity has already been identified as a location that a U-turn movement and an overpass will be required. And we want to look further into the exact location of that. This parallel alignment will also reduce congestion and provide an alternate route for traffic currently using the Cave Springs interchange. So the project scope, we're going to look at an alignment that goes from Cutright Lane, which is a private road north of Treetop and just south of Old Maggie Road, and extends north and crosses I-70 near Batterock College, bisects the Sanford Farms parcels, and ties back into Truman Boulevard just south of Elman Road. This alignment, we really want to investigate the ideal location to maximize the development potential. And we want to look at the ideal location for that U-turn movement for any future possible one-way outer roads. This study is one that we really want to consider environmental impacts, community support, and we want to look to minimize construction costs. As project outcomes, we want to have an economic analysis of the preferred alignment. We want to determine the road section that's necessary to convey the traffic that will be diverted from that Cave Springs interchange, as it is a parallel route. And we want to determine a rough order of magnitude cost for the portion south of I-70, the overpass over I-70 with the U-turn lanes, and for the portion north of I-70 that bisects the Sanford Farm parcels. The financial plan for this project includes 80%, a request for 80% funds from the county with the additional 20% from the city funds.
So our last project's the Elk Point Road realignment project. Elk Point Road is between Sunbelt Road and Elm Street. It's parallel to 370, and there's also an existing Norfolk Southern Railroad in this area. Along the existing Elk Point Road, it's a two-lane minor arterial with very narrow two-foot-wide shoulders and pretty steep drop-offs that contribute to a fair amount of traffic accidents in the area. The road is not, it's within the floodplain, and it's below the 100-year elevation, so it is susceptible to flooding. Over here in this photo, this is a photo at Easter Road looking east towards the Mobile Home Park, and Elm Street would be even further past that than Mobile Home Park. This has got some open agricultural area that we can see potentially being redeveloped with our road project. And then this next photo is looking the opposite direction to the west towards Sunbelt. You can see there's narrow shoulders, there's some steep drop-offs, and kind of some tight curves in here that isn't most ideal for this roadway section. Kind of next to these power lines, this is where the Norfolk Southern Railroad is. So our proposed improvements, at the beginning of the project, between the Mobile Home Park and Elm Street, the roadway will stay in its current location, and we'll be looking at adding a 5-foot wide sidewalk, so we'll have a continuous sidewalk along the entire corridor. As we move west from the Mobile Home Park to Sunbelt, that's where the realignment really occurs. So we're looking at shifting the road to the north to be behind these existing developments that will help encourage redevelopment of the parcels by providing better access. With our typical section, we are providing two 12-foot lanes with wider 10-foot wide shoulders, a continuous 5-foot wide sidewalk on the north side of the road, some shallower side slopes, and the biggest improvement that we're making is we are raising the road out of the 100-year floodplain. The project does have about 1 mile of realignment, and kind of discussed all these improvements already. This is a little hard to see, but this is a little bit of a rendering at the bridge location, the existing bridge over Coal Creek. And we would be providing a barrier to separate the sidewalk from the vehicle traffic. This is the current existing Elm Point Road. You can see it's parallel to the Norfolk Southern Railroad. This is 370 in the background, and this is all that open agricultural area that could be redeveloped. So this is a rendering of the proposed improvements. We shifted the road away from the railroad. It also provides more separation from the railroad that will set us up for some future projects. On the next slide, shifting this away allows us to remove the grade, at-grade railroad crossing to allow a bridge in the future to go over the railroad. It also sets up for some future connections to Truman Road and potentially to 370. So after this project's complete, the safety along Elm Point Road will be increased by providing wider shoulders and clear zone improvements. The risk of flooding will be reduced by raising it out of the 100-year flood vent, and we'll be seeking to redevelop the area by providing better access to the agricultural properties. The financial plan for this project is the city's requesting 80% from the county, with the city matching the remaining 20%. So this is our last project. Now, we went through this pretty fast.
Going back to that,
yeah.
I had the same comment last year, but you got all that right-of-way money, you're improving all those people, you're building a levee for them, aren't you?
In a way, yeah, we are raising the road out of the 100-year floodplain. So any redevelopment on those agricultural properties, they do sit below the 100-year they would be required to raise their sites as well.
I'm saying that, but aren't you buying from the people who are going to be inside that? Is that who you're buying from?
I think of that.
You're improving that whole area, you're improving dramatically from flooding and all that type thing. And we're going to pay them to do that?
Right, so the flooding, it would be upstream, so we would be essentially, you're saying we'd be protecting more of this side.
Right.
Right, but all this would still remain unprotected.
But we've got to pay to do that for them? I mean, when you talk about development, all that type thing, a lot of times, you know, I would assume if I own one of those properties, I'd want you to do this.
But if you're wanting to be redeveloped, so right now, we do not have a developer on board yet, so.
No, if I own that real estate, you're going to improve my property.
Yes.
And I want to be paid for that too. I get it. I mean, like I said, it all depends on where you stay.
Right.
But we are adding value to their real estate. We're not taking anything away that.
This, you presented this last year.
Yeah, essentially the same project.
Same project, yeah.
I feel the same way about it.
Yeah.
From the right of way side, I don't mind doing that, but it just seems like you've got to pay and back on the Hawk's Nest thing, you're going to give $1 million to give better access and clean up of, to me, that property, if you bought the whole thing, might not be worth $1 million. You know, and you're just taking the street and giving a nice, you know, I don't think, I saw what the curb cuts were on that, but I mean, they're going to have.
Yeah, with that project, we did assume a full take on that property.
Okay.
That's why that's so high. During design, we'll reevaluate to see if we could reparcel that remaining section to be redeveloped, but we are looking at purchasing the whole thing.
That's a clear improvement for those, not only their road is improved dramatically, but so has their ability to be flooded and all those type things, so. I mean, to me, more value would be to redo the existing, bring it up, and then but run it all the way over to Truman. It's just from an access standpoint, I mean, it's still farm ground for the most part to run that Elm Point before crossing the tracks all the way over to Truman. Some did.
What's the logic for moving it out there and not, like you said, just improving?
Yes, so moving it out here, it allows us to have development on both sides of the roadway. We don't have any access between the road and the railroad. It also allows us to deal with the future grade separation at Zumbel. Slide. So essentially rebuilding a future bridge over the railroad. This is the last at-grade intersection that we have in the city. So shifting it over, it does multiple benefits.
The other question in the big picture, you all have a time frame of when you think the outer roads would be developed and or you're making some of these projections that in preparation of going that way, is that a foregone conclusion or?
The projects that we've come up with would still function the current 2A. We're just wanting to be prepared so that we're not designing something that would be eliminated with the one-way outer road. But we don't know if that will be the preferred concept or not. It's still being evaluated by MoDOT.
Nick, last year was approved the Zumbel Road study from 94 to 370. So how this road will tie in and all that is included in that study. And so that's just the next piece. And also, while we may be improving the value of the land, their land's still gonna be low compared to the road. So we can try to work with the property owners when we actually get to that point to help try to get them to donate, just as you were indicating.
Yeah, I mean, it makes their site more valuable for redevelopment or just in general.
Yeah. With this concept level.
I mean, the next 93 comes along, they won't get any, if that goes through, they won't get any water, more than likely.
Yeah, just with our application, we're assuming that it won't be donated, so we do have a cost in there if it had to be purchased. Did that answer your question? Any other questions? Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Senator St. Peters?
just getting that up, getting this up here. My name is Bert Vandesek. I'm the manager for Transportation and Development Services for the City of St. Peters. I have one project to present to you tonight, which is a supplemental funding agreement for the Youngman Road Bridge Replacement Project. So this is a project that is currently funded by the St. Charles County Road Board. And just to kind of refamiliarize yourself with the project, this is a replacement of two deficient box culverts on Youngman Road between Barkley Trails and Margaret Brown Court. These box culverts are inspected by MoDOT every 2 years, and they were found structurally deficient. So they're not in a state where they're, you know, dangerous to drive over, but they're at a point now where they were eligible for federal bridge replacement funding. The city applied for that funding and they would receive 80% funding for the replacement of those culverts. The replacement of those culverts and the associated road improvements also address road flooding and flash flooding that occurs in that area. That creek that those culverts serve is flashy, and what happens is the creek doesn't overtop the road, but it surcharges through the storm sewers and then causes flooding on the roadway. And then overall, the pedestrian access, there's a major trail crossing at that location, and the pedestrian facilities there do not meet current ADA standards and need to be improved. And so the scope of the project is to replace those culverts, raise the profile of Youngman Road and to deal with the flooding issue, construct a 10-foot wide multi-use path at Country Creek, and then remove and replace the traffic signal at Country Creek. Though I do want to note that at the original submittal of the project, we were not anticipating having to replace the signal at Country Creek, and I'll explain that a little more later in the presentation. So performance measures is we're going to improve the structural rating of the roadway and improve the hydraulic capacity of the culverts. So this is the area that I'm referring to. So Barkley Trails, Margaret Brown there to the other end of the screen here. This is a 4-barrel box culvert. That's a 2-barrel box culvert. During design of the project, doing the hydraulic analysis, what was found is that we were not able to replace this 4-barrel culvert with a 4-barrel culvert. It needed to be a bridge section. So while that provided the hydraulic capacity for this crossing, and it also presented some additional design opportunities for us. Also, with the conversion of this bridge to, or this culvert to a bridge section, the area, and I have some slides that will show that, but the area of the roadway reconstruction expanded and expanded into the traffic signal, and that's why the Country Creek traffic signal was included. Over here at Margaret Brown, that culvert ended up being taller than anticipated, so that just added some difficulties with utilities, which I'll talk about right now, actually. Also during design, what we found was there is a liquid gas has a 6-inch main that runs along the west side of Youngman Road. That main is located within a private easement, and after doing some research, we were not anticipating that being reimbursable work, but unfortunately, that is going to be reimbursable work, and so we're needing to pay complete gas for the relocation of a portion of that gas main at this location and also at this location to facilitate construction of those projects. The other utility relocation that was not anticipated with this is the relocation of a sanitary sewer line that runs also along the west side of Youngman Road. And this one became a challenge. We were able to make some minor modifications to the sanitary sewer here, and the sewer itself actually is exposed in the creek channel, but we're able to stabilize around that sewer to make that crossing work. However, we don't have that option at this location, so what is proposed to be constructed is a siphon. So if you imagine, you ever try to suck water out of a fish tank, you suck through the pole, the siphon kind of works the same way. But in order to make the siphon work, we had to put some additional flow into that sewer to make it work. So there's a sewer line that runs here, connects to that sewer that runs along the east side. And then there's another sanitary sewer that we're also going to direct that flow across. And what that then allows us to do is lower this sanitary liner, but construct a siphon, which then allows this bridge to be constructed. So several major utility relocations that were not anticipated when the project was originally proposed. These are, this plan sheet's again just kind of showing the project location. What I wanted to show you on this is now we're at the north end of the job, so this is Barkwood Trails. And just wanted to show you basically that the area of the roadway reconstruction expanded. Recall I mentioned the flash flooding and the surcharging from storm sewers. So one of the ways that we're addressing that, in addition to increasing the hydraulic capacity of the bridge of the culverts, is we're actually raising the profile of the road. So this portion of the roadway is being raised right about almost 3 feet. And then continuing, this is the four-barrel box culvert that's being replaced with the bridge. So you can see culvert structure at this location. This is where the bridge structure will be, and you can see that the roadway is significantly higher. And the consequences of that is those roadway improvements extended into the intersection of Country Creek, and therefore we got into that traffic signal and needed to replace the traffic signal. So this is that dip in the road that I'm talking about that we're trying to relieve. So this is that four-barrel box culvert. So we're going to raise the road up about 3 feet and then transition it to the north and to the south to get rid of this dip. And this is one of the areas where you see that flash flood. This is continuing further to the south. So this is Margaret Brown Court. It's a little hard to see in the detail here, but you can see this is the existing box culvert. This is the proposed box culvert. And right through here is that sanitary sewer that I was telling you about that we need to, that we're going to armor. So we're not creating a siphon here on the north culvert, that's where we're putting the siphon, but we're able to stabilize that area. So the status of the project, this project has federal funds, it also is currently road board funded. We have completed design, we have completed all right-of-way acquisition, we do have MoDOT right-of-way clearance. One of the right-of-way was slowed down a little bit, we ended up having to condemn some property to the east, and not that we weren't able to come to an agreement with the subdivision. Their indentures were in a legal state that we could not execute an agreement with them, and so due to the advice of our attorney, we had to proceed with condemnation. Construction, the plan specification and estimate has been submitted to MoDOT. MoDOT Local Roads has recommended it for funding obligation. However, this project got selected for FHWA audit or federal highway audit, so we're in the process of going through that right now. But as soon as the feds are done with us, then hopefully we'll be able to move forward and get this project out. Preliminary utility relocations are slated. Some of them are underway currently. The sanitary sewer relocation, we have project that bid up at our purchasing department and hope to get that out on the street here in a couple weeks. And then that goal being that sanitary line is relocated and out of the way, which would then, once we get authority to advertise, the bridge project would be advertised late 17, early 18, with the project completed December 18. So this was the original project funding. So we had an estimated cost of $2,881,000. We had $1.4 million in federal funds. Road Board was paying 20% of the bridge. So 20% of the 20% match, I guess, is probably the right way to look at it. And then for the roadway improvements, for bridge funds, the way the federal funding structure works, the feds are only going to pay for the bridge themselves and whatever necessary road improvements. When this project was reviewed by East West Gateway and MoDOT, the raising of the road to deal with the flash flooding, they did not consider that eligible for bridge funding. And so that's why there's a difference. So it's basically 80% of the city's 20% match for the bridge portion of the project, and then the road board's paying 80% of the road portion of the project, with the city finishing out the rest. This is what the current project estimate is. We're up to about $2.9 million, so we're well over, and this is just construction. So I just wanted to emphasize That's the total project, that's design, right-of-way, everything. That's the actual construction, that's not design, right-of-way, and everything, that's just construction of the project. So cover this, I've already talked a little bit about how this construction estimate came to be. The box culverts themselves ended up being larger, one of them ended up being a bridge. In addition to that, the federal standards, in order to have these culverts qualified for federal funding, they were classified as structurally obsolete. So what that means is, when we build them, we have to actually build them a little wider than we actually need for the roadway. Normally, you would get a variance for that, but since they use that as a basis for the federal funding, we were held to that wider standard, so these structures are a bit wider than they're fine, but they're just a little wider than maybe would need to be optimal. The roadway reconstruction area was significantly bigger than what we had anticipated, so it's almost $600,000 of that number, and then the additional traffic signal replacement. There's some other miscellaneous costs associated with that, but these are the big ticket items that were part of that overage. So this is the overall project cost. Again, we've completed design. We had estimated $155,000. It ended up costing just under $3 million. Right away, it was pretty close to my estimate on that. Utility relocations ended up being will be significantly more than what was anticipated. We did save some money in construction engineering, so we saved about $50,000 on that. But then when you start looking at the various components of construction, you can see, you know, it's an expensive project. So what I'm asking for tonight, I'm not asking for the full overage. I'm not asking that. What I am asking for is funding for the roadway portion of the overage. So in the funding application, it was about $600,000 in overage for the roadway portion of the project. That's the portion of the project that the road board had approved for funding at 80% rate. I'm just asking, can we extend that and that 80% to the full cost of the roadway reconstruction? That's not including the traffic signal replacement. It's also not including other improvements that are part of it. What that would do is increase the road board contribution from $486,620 to $965,763. And with that approval, this is what the overall project allocation would be. And so that's essentially what I'm asking for tonight. This is what the financial plan is. So I wasn't sure how to write the financial plan, so I'm just focusing on the funding that I'm asking for part of this cycle, but just with the understanding that yes, this project was previously funded through the road board. So at that point, I'd be happy to answer any questions. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you. St. Charles County Highway Department.
St. Charles County Highway Department. I have five projects to talk to you about this afternoon. We have two that are more traditional road improvement widening projects, a couple of bridge replacement projects, and then a current project, large scale intersection project. Let's go ahead and dive right into David Hochul Parkway Phase 1B. The road board is currently funding two projects, actually three if you count the city of Wentzville in this particular area. As you know, City of Wentzville is in the process of finishing up design right away to build an interchange over I-70 out in the South Point Prairie area. And county is now working on design with road board funds to realign South Point Prairie and extend Interstate Drive as David Hochul Parkway Phase 1, already funded. And also we're working at the other end of the project down Highway N with Phase 2 with a realignment of Buckner Road, South Point Prairie. And we actually actually have one more project that's about to go to bid very soon, right in the middle of the limits, which is reconfiguring the intersection at Jackson Road and South Point Prairie. So this project here is to continue those improvements. Still at this point in time, we're just talking about a two-lane road for now, but ultimately anticipate this being a four or five-lane road in the future. So this project is 1.16 miles in length. It's your typical narrow two-lane road with some standard curves horizontally and vertically. Pavement condition varies throughout overall. It's not terrible. It's a 7 out of 10, but that's not the real purpose of the project. And basically what we're talking about doing with this is taking the two narrow lanes, widening them out to 12 feet, adding shoulders on both sides of the road. I'm gonna show you, this is the full lane section of the ultimate David Hochul Parkway, which is basically a five-lane section. And there's a few turn lanes out there. What we're proposing to do for this project, and actually all of those other David Hochul projects, is working from the center line over, having a shoulder, two 12-foot lanes and a shoulder that gets us to the center line. So that would be the anticipated typical section for this phase 1B project. Also what we're doing up on the David Hochul 1 and 2 down at the other. And just a couple pictures just to show you the condition out there. Obviously we've got rolling hills, we've got drop-offs, we've got driveways where you can't see over the sharp curves. So this is the type of things we'd be improving again by widening, straightening, flattening the road.
Go back to the other slide. So with that said, do you have right-of-way for all of that?
The intent is to purchase the entire right-of-way with now, yes.
Okay.
And we're doing that on the other two projects.
Okay. Thank you.
Also. And just to talk about the financials, have not started any work on this project yet. We're shooting for design beginning next year, right away in 2019, and then construction in 2020. For, let's say it's a little over a mile, so our price is just over $4 million. Jump into the next project. This is Hepperman Road Phase 2. As you know, we've talked a lot over the last several months about the first phase of Hepperman Road, and there was just some discussion about whether more traffic now goes south to Highway N down here than goes north to the outer road. And currently much more traffic goes to the north, but in the future, especially as we're talking about those David Hochul Parkway projects and that outer beltway that uses Highway N, we can see in the future that Hepperman Road needs to also to the south to basically finish out the route. We have the road on this end is not as hilly on the other end, but it's the same where we have drop-offs, hard to see driveways, so you have the trees really close to the pavement, four ditches. The pavement on this section is worse as well. It's rated as a 5 out of 10, and there's a very high crash rate on this particular part. Basically anything over a crash rate of about 5 to 7 is considered a high. So we're pretty severe through this section. This project has a length of 0.65 miles. So the typical section we're talking about on this is just keeping it as a two-lane road, 12-foot lanes, 4-foot shoulders. The other section to the north that we're building right now is the same section. There is some turn lanes because there's more side streets, a little more development on the north part of Hepperman. On this phase, there's less development at this point in time. That section to the north has grading on the west side for a future sidewalk, and we just, not build it at this time, but we plan on working that into the typical section of platform if that were needed in the future. So again, we're just talking about two lane, 12-foot lanes, shoulders, improved ditches. So a couple representative pictures of what we have out here. Again, it's not quite as hilly, but we have blind driveways, obviously some really substandard curves, not very good sidelines, things that we can clean up fairly easily. So cost-wise, we anticipate submitting this for federal funding. We are, at this point in time, just to get this moving forward, we'd be looking for design funds. I have it in 19, but we'd certainly be willing to push this up a year to get things going. Basically, design, $230,000, right away, $235,000, construction a little over 2.2 in this, for 0.65 5 miles. Okay. Moving on, this is a one of the two bridge projects I have for you this evening. It's been the St. Charles County's policy that anytime we have a substandard bridge, as soon as it is listed, it's been inspected and listed as sufficiency below 50%, that we will apply for federal funding and have it, therefore, replaced within the next 2 to 3 years. So I don't know that we're significantly ahead of other counties in the state in that regard. We'll put it that way. We have very few deficient bridges on the county highway systems. There's probably only more than 4 or 5 at any given time. Some counties might have 100. So where we're at right now is Nam Road. It's in the far southwestern part of the county, off Highway E. This is actually a one-lane bridge that has a sufficiency rating of 25%, which is very poor, as you'll see from the pictures in a minute. So what we're going to do is widen it out to 2 lanes. It'll be 2 11-foot lanes, 2-foot shoulders, just replacing the ones at the bridge. No real work, like Bert was kind of talking about earlier, just kind of keeping them to the bridge itself. So there's another bridge that county crews had worked on several years back in-house. This is contract work, so we'd be talking about widening this out to 2 lanes then, and it's a typical bridge, a lot of rusting along the edges. It's posted, as you can see from the side, 3.3 tons. So the design cost and right-of-way cost I'm listing here are actually already programmed, but they're programmed internally. So we're using BRO funds, which is an off-system replacement program that the feds and MoDOT have that we can use. There's just not sufficient funds to actually do the construction. So they've given us enough money through BRO funds and some internal funds to start the design right away. Design is underway right now, so we are in the position where we can bid this for construction next year. So we are seeking the $415,000 to replace. Okay, now on something a little bit bigger. This is the Goodmouth Road interchange. This is a project that's already been approved by the Road Board. It's already been approved though for design money only. So we are definitely moving forward for this project that started design. We're in a conceptual design and coordinating with MoDOT right now. So again, just to give you a basic idea of what we're trying to do out here, between Highway K on the west end and Mid Rivers Mall on the east end, it's over 4 miles without an interchange. Both of those changes on either end are severely congested at times. So as we always hoped, even back when this project building 364, the interchange would be put there, this is the time to make that happen. So we are moving forward with this project aggressively. So the scope of this project is to really, the overpass is already there. Goodmouth 30 overpass is 364, so it's adding ramps. And say possible sound wall, it looks very likely. It would probably have a sound wall on both sides on these two quadrants of the interchange. And again, design funds have already been approved, so we're basically about a 20% completion with the design work and moving forward quickly on that. I should also mention that construction funds, some STP money, through the Fed's Resource Gateway has been tentatively approved. We'll find out whenever the board finalizes that, but we're anticipating getting $1.5 million in federal funds on this project. MoDOT is also supposed to be committing $3 million. So where we're at right now, again, I left off the design. That's the million that's already funded. So we're ready to finish the design, move forward with right away next year. It's estimated $2.7 million or thereabouts. And then construction is in the neighborhood of $5 million. And that we can begin as soon as 2019, though we don't get the federal money until 2020. One last project for you, another bridge replacement, same thing as now, and that it's a little more remote area of the county, a little bit closer though. This is up on Seaburger Road, off north of Highway B, just before South Shore. And it's a bridge that, when it was last rated, it came in with a sufficiency of 45.4, which makes it less than 50%, and therefore eligible for federal funds. We do have a lot of bicyclists out there, so we're going to widen this a little more than normal. It'll be 12-foot lanes, 6-foot shoulders. And then this one was approved for federal funds, regular SMP funds. So we'd be ready to start design next year, right away in 19, construction by 2020 or sooner. The federal portion is $440,000, so we need $70,000 for construction. Ultimately, from the road board, we're looking for $167,000 to replace that bridge. And those are the projects I have for you.
As far as states, any overruns? Everything's square now, or?
We're working on much of the.
No overrun, I'm sorry.
No, it's, we're working on budget numbers right now. We're carrying overs into next year, so I will know more in about a week's time, but yes, hopefully. We won't have 10.
Any questions? Thank you very much. Any new business this evening?
Yeah. All right, so Debbie had asked me about the scoring sheets and kind of trying to revise them to make it easier for you guys. So I started looking at it, and I'm gonna do some different scoring by project type, so we can compare them to each other easier and maybe set some thresholds. We'll have to discuss that. So cities, I may be contacting you for additional information or trying to get additional information. We understand that you may not have everything, so we'll kind of deal with what we have this year and next year. We're actually going to change the way we do the application since we had issues this year that kind of came about. But as part of that, we're going to kind of flow you through. As you pick the project type, you're going to have extra things to add based on what kind of project you pick. So we're going to try to make it a little more quantifiable so that it's less of us just kind of saying, well, we think it's a good project. So I will be getting with the cities by next week with what I'm trying to get, and then I'll need it by August 7th. And then for the road board, I will try to get you the scoring sheets by the 14th so that you'll have them before the work session meeting on the 16th. I'm on vacation for a week and a half in here, so I'm going to do my very, very best. So I have a whole bunch of ideas. I wrote down for myself. I'm going to share those now, but at the work set, or I may share them in the email when I send you the information, and then we'll be able to discuss at the work session.
So in August, we won't have a regular meeting, we'll have a work session meeting?
Yes, so that's, yeah, under, if there's any other new business, then we can talk about that under the assessments.
So our next regularly scheduled meeting will be in September?
Yes, so the next meeting, the August meeting will be a work session. It does have to be publicly noted, and, you know, if you have to put it out there, cities, we don't need you to be there. We will likely have it at a park location again, but probably more St. Charles, St. Peter's. We won't go all the way to Winsville. We will stick with this time. We'll stick with this time, and we'll probably bring in dinner. So that's kind of the plan. We'll send out an email with everything, and hopefully that works out.
Thank you.
Yep.
Anything else for this evening?
Are we still dealing with around a $25,000
million? Yes. We will know that before, probably I send out the scoring sheet as well. We'll get all those numbers together and let you know where we're at. Yeah.
You can include in that what we've got an economic development pot. If that's, we did projects last year, I don't know so what that took out of that, but.
I don't think we took any economic development projects out of it, but we have had to move some stuff around for other things, so. We'll kind of just discuss the overall budget.
All right.
Yep.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
Make a motion.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.